This age range is 13 to 17. And as you can see, I write in bold print, this intervention must be supervised and granted permission by the parent to do so as this uses matches and fire. We have candles. Okay? So no one is liable here. This is to get a teenager to symbolize their birth family and their journey thus far. So I get these candles again from the 99-cent store. Just plain white. I think they have different colors too. Stickers, letter writing. It could even just be a piece of paper that I fold in half, and the child's gonna write a letter. And this is to the birth parent that they're no longer living with, that they do have a connection with, and even if the connection is not a good one, they still have things that they need to say and express and say to that person. So, fire is the element that represents passion and spirit and represents the flame that burns inside us. It is both a destroyer and creator, as articulated in the story of the phoenix, which is the mythical bird who burns itself to death in order to rebirth itself again from its own ashes. And that's shared with permission by Katrina Lopez. It's soul to soul. Now, what I love about this is fire, as I just read, represents a healing process. We're burning something and letting it go. This is a ritual. I typically give this candle ritual the day before a child's birthday. I've done this with some younger kids too. You have to do it at your discretion with the parent's permission. And I do it the day before the birthday so the child can honor the two people that brought them into the world. The day before their birthday, because on that birthday, they want to have a good time. We want to be able to process this stuff the day before so they can enjoy their birthday and not feel such loss. Because it is typical for children who've been separated into foster care and/or adoption, birthdays are very difficult because they experience that loss. And they think of their birth family and their birth mother on their birthday, because that's what that day signified. So the child decorates one for the birth mother, one for the birth father. If we know a name, great. If we don't, birth father. They write the name, put stickers, and they can write a letter to each person. Say whatever it is that they need to say. I ask that with the parent, they light it that night, the day before their birthday, and they can either read the letter out loud, they can say something. I also ask parents, the foster parents or adoptive parents, to say something as well to these two people, who are important to them too. Because if we don't honor, regardless of the circumstances of why they were separated, if we don't honor these two people, we're not honoring the child. They are a part of them. They are important and they matter too. So I'll have parents say, you know, thank you for bringing Joseph into the world. Our lives have been filled with so much joy and happiness. Thank you for having him be created. And we hope you're safe, we hope you're well, and we're thinking of you. Simple. Honoring, validating that these two people here exist in that child's world, that internal world. And it's really important to acknowledge that, externalize it, make sense of it, communicate and speak to it, and say what the child needs to say. I ask parents to do this every year, the night before the child's birthday. You know, this candle may burn, and maybe it's burned here the night before. Well, save them, bring them back the next year. Because this represents that loss. And that those birth parents, just because a child's not actively speaking about it, does not mean they're not actively thinking about them all the time. So this gives them an opportunity to externalize it, express it, make sense of it again. Because that's the work here. And it does need to be done over and over and over. because we all work through our loss differently. You know, even the loss of a grandparent, the loss of an animal, you know, it may take us years before we buy a new animal because we still are connected to that animal that passed. So children have to be given opportunities to grieve, to mourn, and release, and accept the loss. So that's the candle ritual. Something else, what else did I do? Oh yeah, that's right. Something else I did with teenagers, yeah, I'll be with you in a minute, is you can get like an aluminum pan, because fire releasing and watching something burn, disintegrate into ashes, is something very, it's almost like it's a native release of some cathartic experience to watch something burn. It's like letting a balloon go in the sky and watching it disappear. Sometimes if a child's having a lot of pain, anger towards a birth parent, I'll have a pan, and this is done outside with a parent, with an adult supervised, and they can write something on a piece of paper. We put it in the aluminum pan and we let it burn. I don't need to know what the teenager wrote on that piece of paper. What I want them to do is get it out, whatever it is, release it to the universe. You know, where does fire come from? How does it, you know, it's an element that helps things disintegrate. Let it go. So I like doing that with teenagers too. They can write whatever they want on a piece of paper. They can write something, say whatever they need to say. They can crumple it up. They can fold it up. We can light it and watch it burn. It's another form of releasing. I've done that with balloons too, not with lighting balloons on fire and watching them go in the sky, where you put a note before you blow up a balloon. You put a little note in the balloon, and then we want it to get helium, and then they can let it go. But we want it to be safe for the environment, so birds don't get hurt. But also I've had helium balloons filled, and then we write things on the balloon that we're still holding on to, still angry about, still sad about, and we write it on the balloon and we watch it, we let it go. So again, forms, rituals to help a child process loss.